Thanks, mate.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Claire, and I've just arrived at the Royal Garden Hotel in High Street, Kensington, to interview Alexander O'Neill. Yes, he's staying here. So I'm going to see if I can take him out to High Street, Kensington Park, and have a chat with him out there. Alex, you've been in hiding. Where have you been?
Dealing with life, Claire. Dealing with life. Actually, you know, as you know, I haven't had a record out for about 3 years now, and you know, actually, just spending some time the first couple of years bonding with my kids, and because before I had such a hectic schedule, I didn't get a chance to spend a lot of time at home, and excluding the fact that I didn't have a record deal too. Over the last 8 or 9 months here. Just signed a new record deal,
right?
With EMI,
okay.
Records here in London, and Claire, that's why I'm here talking to you today.
But is it an album?
Well, yes, it is actually. The single is going to be released on October the 21st of 1996. Yes, and the album will be released on November the 11th.
Yeah,
It is a new album. Matter of fact, I had the opportunity to really get involved with this particular project because I picked all the producers. It's the first album I basically did away from Jimmy Jam, Terry Lewis,
right,
or the Flight Time family. So it's a great challenge for me, but you know, I often describe that after 12 years of being involved with Flight Time, if I don't know what a hit record is, I better get out of this, get out of this business.
So what kind of flavor is that? Is that the same type of music you do? Good and bad times, I had my cloudy days, I had my share of joy and pain, in every kind of way. We all know that time waits for no one, so every opportunity that I still have, I'll show you that we can be loved.
Well, I pretty much describe it as the 1996 Fat Tracks with the vintage Alexander O'Neill. You know, the album, basically, the theme behind it, it's about lovers. You know,
okay.
it's about, you know what I'm saying.
Snoozing.
Getting it on.
Getting it on. So, you know, basically, it's I think it's a very positive album, and it certainly says a lot of positive things, certainly for the female gender.
Right, okay. So let's go back to your younger days. How did you start out?
That's the Stone Age.
Yeah, the Stone Age thing.
Yeah. Actually, probably when I first realized that I had a gift, I was about 9 years old, and this is a funny story. I was singing a James Brown song in the kitchen washing dishes. Because see, I have the type of mother that she don't play boys do this and girls do this. I mean, no, my mother was like, you mop, you clean. We all had turns and day, and I hated doing dishes. I hated doing dishes. And so I was washing dishes in the rain. It was raining and lightning, thunder, and I was like, I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't lie. And all of a sudden, something came down and said, and I felt this electricity. And I got scared, and I ran in the front room. I said, hey, you guys, you know what? I just been struck by lightning. And they all fell out laughing. They said, get out of here. You don't know what you're talking about. And I think that's when it started. I believe the neighborhood kids probably knew that I had a gift for singing more so than I did, because I was into a whole nother thing.
Yeah. So is James Brown somebody that you looked up to?
Well, of course, James. James Brown certainly would come to mind as one of my idols for several different reasons. I think that Otis Redding, Marvin Gaye, Donny Hathaway, those are the type of people that I really admired. But it came a point in time within my own career. Mm-hmm. I never forget when I used to sing locally. Mm-hmm. I would always try to emulate these other artists.
Yeah, sure.
And it comes a time that you, when you really get serious about this and you want to go for it all, you have to find out who you are. So I say, you know what, I'm going to stop trying to sing like Peabo Bryson and all the rest of it. I'm going to find out who Alexander O'Neill is.
Right.
And once I started that, all kind of doors opened up.
Right. So when was the first time you were in the actual studio? What was your first hit?
My first hit was a local hit. Mm-hmm. And a song called Playroom, which is going to reoccur, certainly.
Right.
It's going to reoccur, trust me. It's a beautiful ballad, and I co-wrote it with some friends of mine in Minneapolis. What the song did for me was, we lived in an environment, a predominantly white environment in Minneapolis, Minnesota, very Scandinavian. And the black musical community, we always had a problem of playing white clubs.
Yeah.
You know, and playing, you know, they always was giving us this crossover routine.
Mm-hmm.
So what we decided to do is that sometimes the certain ways you circumvent things like that is that you have to go over it. You can't go through it, because the system of racism has been there for so long.
Yeah.
It hasn't been removed thus far.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, you have to devise plans to go over it. And that's what we did. So we put a local record out called Playroom, and the record was received so well, which what it did was it opened doors, whereas though you didn't have to depend on selling yourself to a club owner, to a white club owner.
Yeah.
You brought your own crowd.
Right.
I bring my own following. So yeah, let's hire Alex, because they're gonna be in here tonight.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So it was that kind of thing.
Right.
And you know, that was a great experience for me.
Yeah. You were telling me about earlier on about your 14-year-old kid,
Is that what is he 14?
No.
He thinks he's 20. I just think that, Claire and I were talking, you know, earlier. And I, on the subject of just kids, and I do, my son, he's like, he's more influenced. Kids nowadays are more influenced by their peers than ever by their parents.
Right.
And so, you have to really hold a firm hand on it, because it seems like when I go away, he starts messing up, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times, as we were saying, it's not because of anything. Totally, a lot of times it's not because of something that a parent did wrong, it's because that's who that kid really is.
Right, okay.
That's their character.
Mm-hmm.
And the only option you have to have is to hang in there forever.
Yeah.
Regardless to what. Mm-hmm. And so I think that it's most important that the problem with the young kids, I feel, of today is that it has to start at home.
Mm-hmm.
It has to start at home. There are a lot of different reasons that for domestic problems and breakups, but there's not too many reasons for why a parent still can't be attentive to their child.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that that's the most important. And two, the system, I know the system that I come from, is designed to basically to keep the black man from the home.
Right.
Because anytime you can take a public system and you can implant the theology of, I don't need a man because I get my check every month because I got this, that, and other going on.
Yeah.
That's exactly, you're playing right into the man's hand. It's just like about the gang banging and all the street activity.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. we're set up to fail. Our kids are set up to fail. And I'm very much so concerned about the demise of the young black youth in this country, in the States, period, because it's a very serious situation. If these kids are supposed to be the future, y'all scaring me to death. Okay?
Do you think that the rap industry is somewhat to blame for maybe the kids getting unruly?
Well, I think that certainly it has contributed to it. And as you know, the rap industry, to be honest, is exploited by the a white man. It's as simple as that. What we have to realize, we have to take more control of our own neighborhoods. Okay? I think that the rap, the whole rap, especially with the gangster rap and the whole nine yards, it's a way negative thing, but it's not going to negate the fact that it's reality, and it's what these kids are rapping about. But who's making money on that reality? Who plants this negativity into our communities and always have? You've never seen a black man. I've never seen a black man get busted with a big airplane full of cocaine or marijuana. How did it get here? Who's doing it? You're setting us up to fail. And I want to say one thing to the kids out there that watch. Don't be tricked out of your dream, because it's your dream to have. Everybody has something special. Don't go into a tug of war about my territory and my streets and this, that, and other. Because let me tell you something, you don't own no streets. Because anytime the police want to come and block those streets off and put you in jail, guess where you go? You go to penitentiary. He goes home. Peace. Beautiful. You know, they're pushing us on our questions, Claire. I see you. The Goosey's going roll, roll, roll. Yeah. Is that the same thing as roll, roll, roll your boat? That means we got to get out of here,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I know. Well, it's been great talking to you. Absolutely splendid.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for taking the time out to speak to us.
Thank you, darling.
Thank you.
Peace.
Best of luck.
All right, baby. You more.